On December 8th, 2023, the Killers celebrated their 20th anniversary with the release of Rebel Diamonds, the band's second greatest hits collection since 2013's Direct Hits, and includes some of the band's most iconic and influential songs over the past two decades. Half a year later, the Killers would celebrate the 20th anniversary of their debut album, Hot Fuss, which was released on June 7th, 2004. The Killers celebrating so many anniversaries as of late inspired me to make a video of some kind to celebrate, and I decided to make an updated ranking of all the band's studio albums from worst to best. I was hoping to release this video sooner to actually coincide with the 20th anniversary of Hot Fuss, but better late than never, I suppose. But before I begin, I should make it clear that this video will only cover Killer studio albums, meaning that records like Sawdust or Live from the Royal Albert Hall will not be ranked, as one is a compilation album and the other is a live album. Sorry, Sawdust fans. Also, for the fun of it, I decided at the end of each segment, I would list the best, worst, and most underrated songs from each album. But keep in mind that a lot of the times when I name something as the worst song from an album, I don't always mean to say, this song is bad. Most of the time, it's just another way of saying, this song is good, but it's the least good song on the album. Keep this in mind if I place a song you like in the worst category. I really don't have much more to say, so let's stop wasting time and get right into it. Okay, so I should probably make this pretty clear right off the bat. Even though Wonderful Wonderful is at the bottom of the list and thus the worst Killers album, I don't actually consider Wonderful Wonderful to be that bad. In fact, I'll go as far as to argue that the Killers have yet to release a truly bad album. But regardless, something had to be at the bottom of the list. The Killers decide to do something completely different with this album, musically and thematically speaking, and I do appreciate the fact that they were willing to try something new with this album, but it's a double-edged sword. On one hand, you do have songs like Wonderful Wonderful, which is an underrated gem, The Man, which is easily my favorite song in the album with its fun disco sound and its tongue-in-cheek commentary on toxic masculinity, and Run for Cover, which sounds most like the Killers of old on this record. I also really like the songs Life to Come and Some Kind of Love, though I don't listen to them that often. I should also point out how the album has a lot of songs that singer Brandon Flowers wrote about his wife and her struggles with mental health, and I think that's sweet. But unfortunately, I'm gonna have to start being mean and talk about the things I don't like about Wonderful Wonderful. I've heard the criticism that Wonderful Wonderful sounds more like a Brandon Flowers solo album than it does a Killers album, but I don't actually agree with this criticism. Sure, Brandon's solo work has its similarities to Wonderful Wonderful, but I think that's true for every Killers album. It's only inevitable that a member of the Killers would have similarities between the music they make on their own and the music they make with the rest of the band, and this is true for Ronnie, Mark, and Dave too. I feel like people make this criticism because Brandon is the band's frontman, which makes him an easier target for this kind of accusation. The problem with Wonderful Wonderful isn't that it sounds too similar to Brandon's solo music or that it tries something different, it's that most of the songs on Wonderful Wonderful, while not bad, aren't good enough to justify the sound change either. I remember hearing Brandon saying he was struggling with writer's block when he wrote this album, and this definitely shows with the occasional bad lyric, even in songs I otherwise like. You got gems such as Clothesline the Shame, Dropkick the Shame, You Got the Soul of a Truck on a Long Distance Haul. Okay. I've seen some Killers fans online saying they like The Calling, but I'm sorry, I don't like it all that much and don't get what the hype is about. Granted, the song does have a good groove to it, but it feels like it's trying too hard to be epic and cool and just feels so out of place with the rest of the album. It's easily my least favorite song on Wonderful Wonderful. And if you'll allow me to continue to be contrarian for a few more moments, I don't think Have All the Songs Been Written is as bad as people say it is. Sure, it's not great and they're definitely so much better on this album, but I think it's better than people give it credit for. I like how emotionally vulnerable Brandon is being with this song, and I love the lyrics Have All These Years Been Worth It or Am I the Great Regret. I don't care what anyone says, that lyric is just heartbreaking. One final point about this album, I don't like how the cover doesn't have the Killers logo on it. I know it's not that big of a deal and putting the logo on the front would change nothing about the album's overall quality, but I don't care. I liked how the Killers plastered their logo on the first four albums, and I don't like that they don't do that anymore, But I digress. Overall, Wonderful Wonderful is my least favorite Killers album, not because of an abundance of anything terrible, but because of a lack of anything great. While Wonderful Wonderful has its shining moments, they don't shine bright enough to elevate this album above an alright listening experience. For the best song on Wonderful Wonderful, I'll have to go with The Man. A lot of people would probably say Run for Cover, and I think that that's a pretty deserving answer of the best song too, but to me, I just like The Man more. Worst song, The Calling. Again, I know it has its fans. A lot of people are probably not going to be happy with me saying The Calling is the worst on this album, but I just don't like it. I think it feels out of place, and it feels like it's trying too hard. Underrated, Wonderful Wonderful. Some people would probably say this doesn't really count because it was released as a promotional single, but I would argue that promotional singles can be underrated too, so I would say that this does count. And I think Wonderful Wonderful is a really great opening track. I love how dark and experimental it is. It's just a very unique song, and I think that despite this album's faults, it at least has a good opening track that really does set the mood very well. My opinion on Day and Age has changed a lot over the years. I used to rank it in the top 3, but then it went down to the bottom of my list, but upon revisiting it, my opinion on the album has softened a bit, but it's obviously still pretty low. Though my opinion has constantly changed, I finally got to a point where I feel confident in my feelings on Day and Age without having to worry about it changing in the future. Probably. Frontman Brandon Flowers has described Day and Age as the Killers' most playful album, and I think that's a pretty apt description. Day and Age is a fun album to listen to, with it having a more jazzy pop sound as opposed to the rock sound of their previous albums. Songs like Spaceman or Joyride are an absolute blast, and of course there's Human with its cryptic and forever debated lyric, Are We Human or Are We Dancer? This album also has its underrated gems such as Losing Touch and Goodnight Travel Well. I know Neon Tiger has its fans, but I'm not crazy about it. It's just kinda meh. I Can't Stay is a song I feel conflicted on. I like Brandon's vocals and lyrics, but the music itself is questionable, to put it nicely. A Dustland Fairy Tale is easily the best on the album. It's a beautiful and heartfelt tribute to Brandon's parents and arguably Brandon's best lyrical work ever. This does beg the question, if Day and Age is such a fun album, then why does it rank so low? Truth be told, for the longest time, I couldn't really answer that question myself, but when I listened to the album for the sake of this video, it finally hit me why Day and Age ranks so low for me. It's not that there's anything inherently wrong or bad about Day and Age, it's just that the sound of the album isn't my preferred sound for the Killers. The jazz pop sound of Day and Age works very well for this album and I don't hate it at all, but when it comes to the music I love the most from the Killers, I strongly prefer their rock music. Day and Age is undoubtedly the most fun the Killers have had with one of their studio albums, and it works for what it is, but my own personal preference for the Killers as a rock band does result in me ranking this album lower than the rest. For the best song, I'll go with A Dustland Fairy Tale. I think that it is undoubtedly the best on this album. The content of the song with the story it's telling and the lyrics I think is just wonderful. The worst song, I Can't Stay. Like I said, a lot of the musical decisions on that one are just weird to me. Underrated song, Losing Touch. I think it was also considering putting Goodnight Travel Well on here, but Goodnight Travel Well is a lot more slower paced and sadder, whereas I feel like Losing Touch is a lot more easy to listen to casually, so I decided to put it in that category. I remember not being all that excited for Imploding the Mirage when it was announced. Not necessarily because I wasn't looking forward to the album, but because this was the band's first release after Wonderful Wonderful, and while I don't hate that album, I did have enough issues with it that I felt cautiously optimistic going into Imploding the Mirage. But then they released the lead single, Caution, and while I didn't love it right away, it eventually grew on me and made me excited for the upcoming album. Then Imploding the Mirage was released, and I loved it. Imploding the Mirage is a thrill to listen to. It's one of those albums where there isn't a single bad song on it. Everything is great. Even the weakest songs in the album have something going for them. The album is also stuffed with some criminally underrated tracks. Dying Breed is one of my favorites on the album. Lightning Fields is another emotional tribute to Brandon's parents. Fire and Bone is kind of weird, but eventually grows on you. My God is a fantastic collaboration with Way's Blood. And When Their Dreams Run Dry is a surprisingly fun song about death. That being said, the album isn't perfect. I know My Own Soul's Warning is a fan favorite, and I used to like it a lot more myself, but now I actually consider it to be one of the weaker entries on the album. It's still a good song, but it doesn't really do it for me like it used to. But that's the only weak part of the album. The only reason why I rank this album so low is less to do with anything significantly wrong with Imploding the Mirage, but more because of how good the rest of the entries are. Imploding the Mirage feels like a massive improvement over Wonderful Wonderful. In fact, I'll even go as far as to say Imploding the Mirage is what Wonderful Wonderful should have been. A new Killers album with a new sound and style, but with music good enough to justify the change. It's a step in the right direction. For best song, I'll go with Caution. Caution, I think, is just the embodiment of what makes Imploding the Mirage so great. Like, if I were to choose one song to represent the whole album, I would definitely choose Caution for that. The worst song, My Own Soul's Warning, this is one of those instances where it's more accurate to call it the least good song in the album, because I still like My Own Soul's Warning, but compared to the rest of the album, I don't like it as much. Underrated song, Lightning Fields. I think there's a lot of songs that could be classified as underrated for Imploding the Mirage, so it's really hard for me to choose one, but Lightning Fields, I think, is really great. Like I said, it's like a really nice emotional track, and there is a collaboration with, I believe her name is Katie Lang, in one part of the song that I think is absolutely amazing, so Lightning Fields goes for the most underrated on this album. There are a lot of Killers fans who would rank Sam's Town as their favorite album, and while it's not my favorite, I still think it's a pretty good answer. Sam's Town is an exceptional follow-up to Hot Fuzz, with Sam's Town having more of an Americana grit to it as opposed to the British-influenced sound of Hot Fuzz. Sam's Town is also notable for having some of the band's best and most underrated songs. Sam's Town, Bling, Confession of a King, Uncle Johnny, Bones, and of course, This River is Wild. This River is Wild is easily the most underrated Killer song ever. This is good enough to be released as a single, and they should have done that instead of releasing Bones as a single. And this is coming from someone who likes Bones. Speaking of, Sam's Town has some pretty solid singles. When You Were Young is the biggest hit on this album, and for good reason. It's arguably the embodiment of what makes Sam's Town great, and who could forget the iconic lyrics, "He doesn't look a thing like Jesus." For Reasons Unknown and Read My Mind aren't as good as When You Were Young, but they're still good singles. Bones is easily the weakest of the singles. As much as I like the song, I don't think it's really single-worthy, and as I said before, I think This River is Wild is far more deserving of the single treatment. And if I'm continuing this trend of criticism, my list and Why Do I Keep Counting are my least favorite songs on the album. They're not terrible by any means, but they're nowhere as good as the rest of the album. And, truth be told, I much prefer Peace of Mind over My List and wish they included that on the album instead. But, all of that aside, Sam's Town is still a great album, and any criticisms I make of it aren't really that big of a deal and don't stop the album from being great. Best song, When You Were Young. I know this might seem like a bit of an obvious answer, but honestly, I feel that When You Were Young is hands down the best on this album. Worst song, My List. This is another one where it has its fans, but personally, I just don't really care for it all that much. And like I said before, I think Peace of Mind would have been better for the album. But that being said, I don't hate My List. I still think it's a good song, and it is the least good song on the album. So don't get too mad at me for ranking it here. As for underrated song, This River is Wild. I think it's the most underrated song in this album, and I think it's the most underrated Killer song ever, period. I absolutely love it and wish it would get more attention. I was honestly surprised by how highly Pressure Machine ranked when I ranked the albums, but it was a welcome surprise, and I honestly think Pressure Machine deserves to rank so highly. Pressure Machine was released the year after Imploding the Mirage, and the contrast between the two is like night and day. I already liked Imploding the Mirage, so for the Killers to release an album so shortly after that's even better was just jaw-dropping to me. Pressure Machine is about Brandon Flowers reflecting on his life growing up in the small town of Nephi, Utah, and the struggles of small town America. And as a resident of a small town myself, this album really resonated with me. Pressure Machine is the darkest Killers album to date, with the band tackling much more mature subject matter that they wouldn't have touched 10 years before. Opioid addiction is mentioned in West Hills, Quiet Town, and In Another Life. Quiet Town mentions a real-life incident from Nephi where a teenage couple were killed by a train. Terrible Thing is told from the point of view of a depressed, closeted gay kid who's considering suicide due to living in a homophobic community. Desperate Things is about a cop who starts an affair with a domestic abuse victim and he murders the abuser at the end of the song. And that's just a few of the songs on the album. That being said, I can kind of understand some people not liking this album because it's too depressing for them. But personally, I love that the Killers were willing to tackle such heavy subject matter with this album. It feels like the band has really matured. They came a long way since the days of Hot Fuzz, and this is coming from someone who loves Hot Fuzz. A controversial aspect of the album is the interviews they play before most of the songs. Some people claim the interviews ruin the album, and they couldn't be more wrong. I genuinely do not understand for the life of me how someone can dislike the interviews because the album is so much worse without them. Listening to Pressure Machine without the interviews is like listening to All These Things I've Done without the bridge. I've seen the criticism that the interviews don't have anything to do with the songs they play with, but that's not the point. The interviews don't serve the songs they're on, they serve the album as a whole. You're listening to real Nephi residents offer their opinions and perspectives on their lives, which adds a real human element to the album and makes it feel more grounded. I can understand listening to the abridged versions of the songs if you just want to listen to the songs on their own, but if you're listening to the album start to finish, the interviews are a must. There are some songs on Pressure Machine that I'm not too crazy about personally, but that doesn't really matter all that much because while I don't love all the songs, it's not enough for me to love the album any less. The Killers did something truly special with Pressure Machine. In fact, a strong argument could be made that Pressure Machine is their best album yet. I honestly could go on for hours and hours talking about how good Pressure Machine is, but with the limited time I have, I will say that Pressure Machine's dark, mature, and relatable subject matter make it one of my all-time favorite Killers albums. For the best song, I kind of cheated a little, and I made a tie between West Hills and Quiet Town. I think I prefer Quiet Town more, but I think that West Hills does a better job at introducing the album as a whole and serving as a good first track on the album. For the worst song, this is another least good song incident with In Another Life. I do like that song, but there are songs on it that I much prefer over In Another Life, and this one does kind of have to be put at the bottom, unfortunately. Underrated song, The Getting By. This is another one of those albums where there's a lot of songs that could go into the underrated category, and I did have a lot to choose from, but I decided that The Getting By was the one that deserved it the most. I think that it is a nice, bittersweet way to end off the album. It does kind of feel like a comforting hug at the end of like such a dark listening experience, and I really like it a lot. Hot Fuzz was my introduction to the Killers when I was a kid, and it would have also been an introduction to the Killers for a lot of other people, as this was the band's debut album. And for first outing, this is a damn good first impression. Hot Fuzz starts off strong with some of the Killers' best and most iconic songs. Jenny Was a Friend of Mine is a fantastic opener, Mr. Brightside is iconic as hell and never gets old, Somebody Told Me is fast and epic and has some iconic lyrics, and All These Things That I've Done is hands down my favorite song on the album, as well as my favorite Killer song and my favorite song of all time, period. I love it so much that the lyric from the bridge, "I got soul but I'm not a soldier," is my senior quote. That being said, Hot Fuzz isn't perfect. The first half of Hot Fuzz is undoubtedly the superior half of the album, and I have noticed that it is common for people to say that they instantly fell in love with the songs from the first half of the album, but they needed some time for the songs on the second half to grow on them, and I had a similar experience with Hot Fuzz as well. But once the second half grows on you, you'll come to find that it has its highlights. Andy, You're a Star, Change Your Mind, and Everything Will Be Alright are the most underrated songs on the album. Change Your Mind is my personal favorite of those three, but Everything Will Be Alright is a close second with its unique atmosphere, romantic lyrics, and swooning guitar solo. It's a great way to close the album. Aesthetically speaking, I really love the synthwave neo-British sound that Hot Fuzz has. A lot of people actually thought the Killers were a British band when Hot Fuzz was released, and I don't entirely blame them, because it does sound like a British album. Hot Fuzz's heavy use of synthesizers and the echo effect that Brandon applies to his vocals give the album its own unique identity and establish the tone of the Killers as a band, a sound that they would continue to change and evolve as their career continued. There are many people out there who name Hot Fuzz as their favorite Killers album, and it definitely deserves such a high honor. Hot Fuzz was the first Killers album, so some respect is owed to it for starting such a legacy. I would even go as far as to argue that, objectively speaking, Hot Fuzz is the best Killers album, not only because it's the band's most successful and iconic record, but because I don't think the Killers have truly managed to ever top it. They have made tons of great albums over the years, don't get me wrong, but as good as those are, there's this magic to Hot Fuzz that just can't be replicated no matter how hard they try, and I'm kind of glad they didn't try to make Hot Fuzz 2. I think it's better that they did something different for each album afterwards. It makes their discography feel more diverse and interesting. But Hot Fuzz is where it all started, and out of all the albums the Killers put out, I feel it best defines their sound and style as a band. For the best song, again, I kind of cheated and put two songs in one, Mr. Brightside and All These Things I've Done. Personally, I like All These Things I've Done more, but Mr. Brightside is also a really good song. It is the biggest hit on this album, and I do really love Mr. Brightside. And I kind of had this dilemma where I wasn't sure which song to put there, if it should be Brightside or All These Things, and I felt like I couldn't put one song in the best category without feeling like I was disrespecting the other song in some way, so I decided to just cheat and put them both in the best song category. I feel like that was the best compromise I could make with that dilemma that I was having. For the worst song, I'm gonna have to go with Believe Me, Natalie. This is definitely another one of those least good things where it's still a good song and I like it a lot, but I like the rest of the album more. Underrated song, again, there's a lot of different answers for this one, but I'm gonna have to go with Change Your Mind. This one does kind of have a strong 2000s rock aesthetic to it that I really like, and it is one of my favorites from this album. Some people may be confused by me ranking Battleborn at the top, considering I just said that I think Hot Fuzz is objectively the best album, so allow me to clarify. I think that objectively Hot Fuzz is the best Killers album, but this ranking is mostly based on my subjective feelings on each album. And while Hot Fuzz is objectively the best Killers album, subjectively, Battleborn is my favorite Killers album. Now, I do have to be completely transparent about this. My opinion on Battleborn is mostly biased. Listening to Battleborn in middle school is what made me into a diehard Killers fan. Not to mention a good chunk of the album is so nostalgic to me that I can't help but view this thing through massive rose-tinted glasses. But even without my biased influence, Battleborn is still a great album. With Battleborn, it feels like the Killers were going for more epic and loud music, and that's what I love about this album. Flesh and Bone, Runaways, Miss Atomic Bomb, and Battleborn are undoubtedly epic and establish the tone for this album, but Battleborn isn't afraid to have some quieter moments, like Heart of a Girl and Be Still. Then there are songs that lie between the two extremes, like The Way It Was, Here With Me, and Deadlines and Commitments. Deadlines and Commitments, specifically, is one of the most underrated songs on this album, and one of the most nostalgic for me, personally. But, as much as I love this album, I do have to be fair and criticize some things about it. There are some songs on Battleborn that I'm not too crazy about. The Rising Tide is easily the weakest song in the album. From Here On Out is fun, but nothing all that special when compared to the better songs on Battleborn. And, weirdly enough, A Matter of Time doesn't do it for me. And the reason I say it's weird is because I can't really think of anything that's wrong with A Matter of Time, and I do enjoy listening to it, but for some reason or another, it doesn't really work for me. Battleborn had a mixed reception among fans when it first came out. Some people even went as far as to rank Battleborn as their least favorite Killers album, and that's a bunch of bullshit. I can understand ranking Hot Fuss or Sam's Town over Battleborn, but if you were to argue that Battleborn was bad, then what were you smoking? But in recent years, people seem to have come around on Battleborn, and it has something of a resurgence where people are actually starting to like the album, and that makes me happy. It's about time that people appreciate how good Battleborn is. Like I said before, my opinion of Battleborn is very, very biased. I can't help it. That's just how it is. Everyone has a biased opinion of some kind. It only becomes a problem when you're not honest enough to admit to your own bias. And while I'm willing to admit that my opinion on Battleborn is biased, I still think it's a good album, objectively speaking. It may not be the best album from The Killers, but it is my personal favorite. For the best song, I'll go with Be Still. It was kind of difficult for me to choose a best song because there are so many good ones on this album. But I think that Be Still might be my favorite out of everything. It is a very peaceful and comforting song, and it is my go-to comfort song whenever I'm feeling down. And it is definitely just one of my favorite Killer songs, period. I absolutely love it. Worst song, I'm gonna have to go with The Rising Tide. It's not terrible. There are some things about it that I do like, but overall, it just doesn't really stand out that much to me. Underrated song, again, this is a 2-in-1, Deadlines and Commitments and Heart of a Girl. Deadlines and Commitments, I think I might like more between the two of them. This song is super nostalgic for me, and I love it to bits, and I don't really understand why there are some people out there who say they don't like the song all that much. Heart of a Girl, I think, is absolutely beautiful, and another really strong hitter from this album. And again, it's just one of those things where people say they don't like it. I'm just like, why not? It's great. At the time of writing, it's been 8 months since The Killers celebrated their 20th anniversary with their second greatest hits collection, Rebel Diamonds. I know a lot of people were disappointed with Rebel Diamonds because of the track listing, but I don't like the fact that so many people have gotten hung up on the track listing because I feel that's missing the point of the album. Rebel Diamonds isn't about the track list, it's about celebrating 20 years of The Killers. And yeah, maybe they could have had a better track list, but so what? It's the thought that counts. It's very clear that The Killers made Rebel Diamonds with love, as made evident by the accompanying video they released where Brandon Flowers offers some of his favorite memories from the past 20 years. To see the band making an album with their hearts on their sleeves like this, and for people to complain about it, it just feels like people are being ungrateful to me. While it's been 20 years for The Killers, it's only been 10 years for me. True, I was alive when The Killers came onto the scene in 2003, but I was only 3 years old at the time, and even if I did hear some Killer songs at the time, I clearly don't remember it now, so it doesn't really count as far as I'm concerned. I wasn't properly introduced to The Killers until I listened to Hot Fuss in the late 2000s, but even then, it wasn't until I listened to Battleborn when I was in middle school that I finally became a fan, and that was 10 years ago. I still vividly remember listening to Battleborn and Direct Hits all the time. I remember jamming out to Shot at the Night and Just Another Girl like it was yesterday. The fact that that was 10 years ago is wild to me. And a lot has happened in those 10 years. The Killers have finally ended their annual tradition of releasing Christmas music for charity. The Killers started being overtly political with the release of their 2019 single, Land of the Free. The lineup of the band has changed significantly as Dave Kooning and Mark Stormer have taken breaks from the band for personal reasons. And The Killers put out 3 new albums, one of which is unlike anything they've released before and sees The Killers tackling darker and more mature subject matter. There's gonna come a day when The Killers celebrate their 30th anniversary with a third greatest hits album, and God only knows what type of music and albums they'll release in that time. All I know is that I look forward to it. The Killers have offered a lot in the past 20 years, and while not all of it was perfect, most of it was great. The Killers have been hitting it out of the park for 20 years, and here's to them doing more great things for the years to come.